Welcome back, Daily Caller. It is Friday ahead of Labor Day weekend, a much-needed reprieve from the campaign trail. I'm sitting down today with our good friend, Republican strategist Adam Goodman. We're going to talk about the last couple of weeks since we last, you know, were able to meet up via Skype, going over the DNC, the RNC, and looking forward to the last couple of weeks in the 2020 election. So, Adam, how are you this morning?
Great to be with you again.
Before we begin, I'm going to remind everyone at home, hit the bell, hit subscribe. That way, every time one of these election dissection interviews goes live, you get a notification on your phone. So let's start with the RNC, because on the one hand, it was sort of a strange occurrence in the history of modern politics. We've never seen the White House transformed into basically a campaign stage on this scale. That being said, President basically stuck to script. They did a good job of rolling out alternative voices in support of the president. What was your take on the delivery of that event? And do you think it positions Trump well to head into these last couple of months?
Well, two responses to that, Christian. One is, what a show. I mean, Steven Spielberg and the others, who tend to be on the other side of the line, looked at this four-day production and had to admit to themselves, from a filmic choreographed standpoint, it was incredible. I actually wrote a piece called it The Greatest Show on Earth, Part Two, not to take away from Charlton Heston's great film from, you know, half a century ago. It was amazing, the pace of it, the feel of it. And yes, there may have been technical violations of the Hatch Act in staging at the White House, Fort McHenry and other things, but wow. And in fact, as much as I thought the White House was an incredible stage, what we saw with Mike Pence on the third night, surrounded by the history of Fort McHenry, I mean, regardless of how you go in this election, you have to stand back and say, that was some moment. He was actually really good. So to your second question, I think, you know, you're talking about 20 million or so who tuned in via broadcast, about the same numbers as the Democrats, more online, obviously. But put that in perspective. The first debate between Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump in 16 generated 81 million viewers, so four times the viewership. So I see this as a table setter. I think they did a good job of setting the table about the contrast of not just personalities, but issues. But the real show is about to come on September 27th, I think it is, when the first debate happens at Case Western Reserve. And for that, Christian, make sure you got as close to a front row seat as you can. That will be, I think, historic and determinative in this election.
Yeah, that's a good point. I think ultimately everyone has known for the past couple of months, this election will come down to the debates. We've even seen the Biden campaign sort of adjust their strategies coming out of the convention weeks. Joe Biden hit the campaign trail in a modified sense earlier than expected. What do you think the Biden campaign is talking about behind closed doors, given this shift in strategy? Is there one area, perhaps on policy, that they're going to be hitting harder than others? And do you think there might be some states that he or Kamala Harris might be hitting that we didn't expect them to visit ahead of the debates?
There are two things that I think freak out Joe Biden at night, when he's in the cool of the night, when he's all alone. One is law and order. And obviously, with Kenosha being the last example of civil unrest, he obviously is trying to hug that cushion as best he can. Frankly, if it's a square off between Donald Trump and Joe Biden on who's going to put their foot down and make sure violence doesn't sweep across other towns and cities across America, I think America is going to largely bet on the president. So I think that's one of the demons, you might say, that's dancing in Joe Biden's head. The other one is clear. He must be saying to himself, if there is one thing beyond that that could cost me this election, if he believes in his own polls, it is the debates, the three debates, that I'm just going to come apart. He knows it's not his strength. Also, we've seen in this cycle, Christian, that when he was under pressure, especially in the early debates from his primary contestants at that point, Kamala Harris included, he was not good. He was very uncertain. He seemed, kind of vacillating between being strong and being, you know, sympathetic. He was not in command of information. And you know, if nothing else, that the president of the United States At this point, still the undefeated champ is going to come. He's got that, I think, is what keeps Joe Biden up at night.
Yeah, the polls would certainly indicate that this is a closer race now than it was, you know, even a month ago, 2 months ago, when we were really in the midst of the coronavirus pandemic. That being said, and I'm not sure how closely our audience at home is paying attention to this, obviously it's captivated us inside the Beltway. The Atlantic and Jeffrey Goldberg dropped a pretty damning story about the president. And we often talk about how Trump is his own worst enemy. Yet this story about how he was disparaging of veterans, of POWs, how he, depending on how you want to frame it, disrespected John Kelly's late son when they were visiting his grave on Memorial Day. Do you think this will impact Trump negatively, given his support among the military members and how he often talks about how he does more for the troops than any other president in history?
Well, you just kind of said it in your question. He has done more for the troops than any president in memory. That's not open to dispute. It's a fact. The story itself certainly doesn't help him. But we saw what happened in 2016 when it came to John McCain and how that ultimately played out. We are moving in a faster world than ever, Christian, where stories are consumed by other stories by the day. So I'd say bad, tough story today, maybe tomorrow into the weekend. Then next week it will be something else. The biggest story of the day, of course, is COVID-19. And there's better news, it seems, afoot. Infection rates in certain states, my home state of Florida, are down to lows they haven't seen in a number of months. We are opening up. I think we're going to have news that goes up and down on that. But the bigger thing is the pace of vaccines being brought potentially to market by the end of the year. So that, I think, is that. And of course, you know, the economy, jobs and the economy are going to be the predominant things at the end. But the joker in all this became something that didn't, I think, seem apparent, Christian, a couple months ago. But to me, when Kenosha blew up, it became, I think, a front burner issue. Will we be safe? Will we be safe in an environment of a cancel culture driven by a movement that knows no compromise? You saw they just went after the mayor of Portland, who is way to the left in the ideological spectrum, and calling on him to resign. It's just, I think, the beginning of a feeling that things are coming apart a bit. And if you want, you know, a sense of stability, even with the president of the United States, who is kind of the master disruptor, he is a better play, I think, on that front than Joe Biden. And in the cool of night, at the end of this campaign, that's something I think that will emanate not from the head, but from the heart.
Yeah, it's a good point. And I actually was able to obtain some of Trump World's internal polling numbers. And that shows that people are still really concerned about COVID recovery. They're concerned about the economy and jobs. And obviously, we had the jobs report come out today. I haven't gotten a chance to pour through it yet myself. But even the outside polling, Reuters, Morning Consult, show that people are way more concerned with jobs than law and order, yet the Trump campaign seems to be hanging their hat on that. Meanwhile, both sides are sort of sowing the seeds of possible contesting of the election. Obviously, the president talks about all of the flaws that go along with moving to a more mail-in style election. Joe Biden and his supporters have talked about how if Trump loses, he's going to need to be removed from the Oval Office by force. You were involved in the recount effort back in 2000. What was it like just going through sort of a crazy end to an already crazy election? And what do you think the 2020 election might be like, given that there's going to be more than one state that could potentially not have results even like a week after election night?
It was mayhem. I was working with Catherine Harris on all the public statements that were coming out at that point to the world. We had no certainty about where the count was ultimately going to go. And what was unknown is that the Secretary of State doesn't control the count. She reports the count from 67 independent supervisors of elections, all of whom had different systems. The chilling thing about your question is that was one state, and it took weeks and weeks to work its way through the Florida Supreme Court and ultimately to the U.S. Supreme Court to determine the answer to who won Florida. Imagine 4, 5, or 6 states that are within margins of error in a campaign where we have a volume of vote by mail unprecedented, and with all sorts of issues that absolutely are going to come to the fore about the process. See, I'm less concerned and less focused on fraud. I'm more focused on just the fact that these supervisors have never handled this kind of volume before from the mailbox, and they don't have the equipment to really do this well. So I guarantee you there are going to be issues. And because of that, there'll be legal consequences and suits brought in a lot of these, I think, swing states, if they're within margin of error. And we could have not one or two, but maybe 4, 5, or 6 states having to decide in their own courts who they thought won, then flipping that, of course, to the U.S. Supreme Court for another decision, which may not happen, Christian, until we're almost at the end of the year, if not bleeding into January.
Well, it would only make sense that such a crazy year will be topped off with a crazy end to the election. So I hope it doesn't come to that, but we'll be prepared if so. Anyway, Adam, it's always great catching up to you. Appreciate you coming on the show, and we'll make sure to pick this conversation up sometime down the line.
Looking forward to doing it again, Christian. Take care of yourself.
And to all of our viewers out there, hit subscribe if you haven't done it already. Watch all these election dissection videos for great guests like Adam and others. I'm Christian Datoc. We'll see you next time.